Welcome to our deep dive into satire, irony, allegory, and symbolism. You've been exploring these literary devices and how authors use them to get us thinking about complex ideas. Mm-hmm. And today we're going to use your notes and a document called Week 5 Live Lessons Yearlong to really break down how these tools work. And
sounds good.
Don't worry, we'll use plenty of examples to make it all crystal clear.
I think we'll find that these techniques aren't just for literature. They pop up, like, everywhere.
Oh, yeah.
Even in your everyday life.
So let's start with satire.
Oh.
What comes to mind when you hear that word? What's your gut reaction?
Well, satire is all about using wit and humor to point out flaws and spark a conversation, whether it's targeting a person, an institution, or an idea.
Yeah.
Satire aims to expose those flaws, challenge beliefs, and maybe even nudge things towards change.
It's interesting you say nudge towards change, because I think we often associate satire with being very pointed and direct. Like those late night comedy shows that you mentioned in your notes.
Right.
Think Stephen Colbert, Keen Peele, or Dave Chappelle.
Yeah.
They don't shy away from hot button topics.
Right. They use a variety of techniques to get their point across.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes the most effective approach is to exaggerate the issue.
Okay.
Blowing things out of proportion to highlight the absurdity of the situation.
It's like that saying, you can't make the stuff up.
Yeah.
But sometimes satirists do make it up, taking things to an extreme to make us see the problem more clearly.
Exactly. And what's fascinating is that they can do all of this while still being entertaining.
Right.
Humor is a crucial element of satire.
Uh-huh.
It allows these comedians and writers to tackle serious issues without coming across as preachy or alienating their audience.
It's like slipping in a Trojan horse of deeper meaning disguised as a good laugh.
Exactly.
And speaking of clever techniques, let's dive into irony. You even highlighted the phrase thoughts and prayers in your notes, particularly in response to gun violence.
Mm-hmm.
What makes that ironic?
Well, consider the intended meaning of thoughts and prayers.
Okay.
It's meant to express sympathy and support.
Right.
In the context of a tragedy like gun violence, critics argue that these words ring hollow without concrete action to prevent future tragedies.
Right.
So the intended comfort clashes with a perceived lack of tangible action.
Yeah.
Creating that disconnect that is so central to irony.
So it's not just about saying the opposite of what you mean, like sarcasm.
Right.
It's about a deeper discrepancy between intention and reality.
Exactly. And there are actually several types of irony.
Okay.
Situational irony, for example, occurs when the outcome of the situation is completely different from what was expected.
Like waiting patiently for the crosswalk signal to change, and then as you step off the curb getting hit by a car.
Right.
That's not the outcome that anyone's hoping for.
Right. Or imagine someone wins the lottery and then trips on their way to collect the prize.
Oh, no.
Breaking their leg and ending up in a worse situation than before.
Yeah.
That's classic situational irony.
Wow.
Then there's verbal irony.
Okay.
Where the speaker says something that's the opposite of what they mean.
Like that time your friend shows up late looking disheveled and you say, wow, you look fantastic.
Right.
It's all about the tone.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
But let's bring this back to satire.
Okay.
We've talked about the techniques, but how do characters play a role in creating a successful satire?
Characters are often how satirists bring their critiques to life.
Okay.
These characters might embody the very ideas being mocked, making their flaws easier to scrutinize.
Yeah.
Or they might expose societal problems through their actions and dialogue, essentially acting as a mouthpiece for the author's message.
It's like they're puppets,
right.
But instead of strings, they're being controlled by the author's satirical intent.
Exactly.
Their actions and words become a way to expose hypocrisy.
Uh-huh.
Highlight social issues.
Precisely.
It's not just what they say, but also how they behave and the choices they make.
Yeah.
It all adds up to a bigger statement.
It does.
Now, let's shift gears a bit and talk about literary devices more broadly.
Okay.
Specifically, some of the definitions that you highlighted from your Week 5 Live Lessons document.
All right.
All right. So you've got a few terms marked in your notes.
Yeah.
Illusion, imagery, and symbolism.
That sounds good.
Let's start with illusion.
Okay.
You've got an example here that says, my hopes sank faster than the Titanic.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty vivid, right?
Yeah.
What makes this an illusion?
What makes that an illusion is that it directly references a well-known event.
Right.
In this case, the sinking of the Titanic.
Mm-hmm.
And it does this to evoke a strong image and feeling in the reader's mind.
Okay.
Instantly conveying the idea of something being lost quickly and tragically.
So it's a shortcut to conveying a lot of meaning and emotion without spelling everything out.
Next, we have imagery, which you've also highlighted with an example.
Okay.
The golden sun dipped into the calm surface of the lake while fireflies began to dance in the air around her.
Mm-hmm.
What stands out to you about this sentence?
Well, it's incredibly descriptive.
Yeah.
I can practically picture the scene in my mind, the colors, the movement, yeah, the serenity of the moment. It's like I'm right there by the lake.
It makes the story come alive.
It does.
And finally, you've marked symbolism with the example. Watching the bird flying free in the sky, she felt a fragile sense of hope and possibility. Maybe today would be different.
Mm.
So here, the bird isn't just a bird, is it? It
right.
takes on a symbolic meaning.
Yeah.
It represents freedom, hope, and the potential for change.
Mm.
And that adds a whole new layer of meaning to the sentence, inviting us to think beyond the literal.
Exactly.
It's like a secret message embedded within the story.
Right.
Speaking of hidden messages, let's talk about foreshadowing, which you also have highlighted. It's basically about dropping hints about what might happen later in the story.
You got it. It's all about creating suspense
mm-hmm.
and keeping the reader guessing.
Right.
Think of it like a breadcrumb trail, leading the reader towards what might be coming next.
Okay. And you've got a great example of foreshadowing here from your notes.
Okay.
Sam walked carefully across the floor, focusing completely on making no sound. He knew the intruder was in the house, but had no idea where. Whoever it was clear they were playing with him, trying to paralyze him with fear. But Sam was not going to just sit there and wait. He was going to get out. He could be careful. He could be quiet. Could he be quiet enough?
That passage is dripping with suspense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The author is clearly setting us up for something tense.
Right.
Using details like the unknown intruder.
Yeah.
And Sam's determination to escape.
Right.
It makes you wonder what's going to happen next, doesn't it?
It totally does.
Yeah.
You can't help but feel a sense of dread and anticipation.
Mm.
But before we get too caught up in the suspense, let's move on to another literary device you've been exploring, allegory. Specifically, let's talk about Animal Farm,
okay.
which is considered a classic example of allegory in literature.
Animal Farm is a great place to start.
Yeah.
It perfectly demonstrates how an author can use an entire narrative
yeah.
to represent something larger than itself.
Hmm.
On the surface, it's a story about animals rebelling against their human farmer.
Right.
But underneath that, it's a scathing critique of the Soviet Union under Stalin's rule.
So the whole story is like a giant metaphor where each element stands for something else.
Exactly.
The animals represent different factions of Russian society.
Right.
The farm itself represents the nation.
Uh-huh.
And the pigs, with their lust for power, represent the corrupting influence of totalitarian regimes.
Exactly.
And that's what makes allegory so effective.
Yeah.
It allows authors to tackle sensitive and often dangerous topics
uh-huh.
without directly confronting those in power. It's like a secret code, a way to speak truth to power without getting silenced.
Right.
Readers who understand the allegory can see the true message,
yeah.
while those who don't might simply enjoy the surface-level story.
Exactly.
And that's why Animal Farm has resonated with readers for generations.
Right.
It's a timeless tale that speaks to the dangers of totalitarianism and the abuse of power, no matter the time or place.
Mm-hmm.
It's like looking through a distorted mirror, seeing the flaws of society reflected back at us in a way that's both entertaining and thought-provoking.
Yeah.
But before we get too deep into Animal Farm, let's take a quick break.
Okay.
When we come back, we'll delve into the specific symbols within the story and how they contribute to the overall allegory.
Sounds good.
Welcome back to our deep dive. Before we went down that rabbit hole of foreshadowing, we were talking about Animal Farm as a classic example of allegory.
Uh-huh.
It's fascinating how George Orwell created this whole world that on the surface is about animals running a farm, but really is a commentary on something much bigger.
It's a brilliant use of allegory. And one of the things that makes it so effective is how Orwell uses individual symbols within the story
right.
to reinforce that larger allegorical meaning.
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned the windmill earlier.
Yeah.
And I think that's a great example to unpack.
Right. In my notes, I have the windmill circled as a symbol of the pig's ambition.
Okay.
But I'm curious to hear your take on it. How does that symbol function within the overall allegory?
Well, think about how the windmill is introduced.
Okay.
It's presented as a symbol of progress,
uh-huh.
a way to make life easier for all the animals on the farm.
Yeah.
It's this grand idea that represents hope and a better future.
It's like a beacon of change. a promise of a more utopian society.
Right.
But we both know Animal Farm doesn't exactly have a happy ending.
Yeah.
So how does the meaning of the windmill shift as the story progresses?
That's where it gets really interesting.
Okay.
As the pigs gain more power, the windmill project becomes less about benefiting the entire community.
Right.
And more about consolidating their own control.
Okay.
It becomes a symbol of their ambition, not for the good of all, but for their own selfish gain.
So the windmill, which started as a symbol of progress and hope, becomes twisted into a symbol of oppression and tyranny.
Right.
It's like the pigs are literally building their own power structure on the backs of the other animals.
That's a great way to put it.
Yeah.
And it's not just the windmill.
Okay.
Think about the seven commandments of animalism.
Right.
Those commandments start as principles of equality and liberation.
Yeah.
The very foundation of the animal rebellion.
Right.
But how do the pigs use them as the story unfolds?
They start twisting the commandments to serve their own interests, don't they? They change them, reinterpret them, and eventually the commandments become just another tool for controlling the other animals.
Exactly.
Yeah.
The commandments, which were meant to represent freedom and justice,
right,
become tools of propaganda,
mm-hmm,
used to justify the pigs' increasingly tyrannical rule.
It's a chilling reminder of how easily language can be manipulated to serve those in power.
It is.
And then there's the character of Old Major.
Yeah.
He's the wise old pig who inspires the rebellion with his dreams of an egalitarian society.
Right.
He's seen as a visionary, a symbol of hope for a better future.
Yeah.
But how do you see his role within the larger allegory?
Well, Old Major represents the initial idealism of the revolution.
Okay.
He embodies the pure intentions of creating a society
where
all animals are equal.
Yeah.
But tragically, his vision gets corrupted by the pigs who come after him.
So he represents both the hope for change and the naivete of those who believe in utopian visions.
Precisely.
His death early in the story is symbolic of the way pure ideals can be crushed by the realities of power and greed.
It is.
It's a heartbreaking reminder that even the best intentions can be twisted and corrupted.
Yeah.
And that those who come to power often prioritize their own self-interest over the common good. But, you know, as we're talking about all these symbols and how they function within the allegory of Animal Farm, I'm realizing that these same techniques are used all around us.
Oh, yeah.
Not just in literature.
That's an insightful observation. Think about political cartoons, for example.
Right.
They often use satire and symbolism to comment on current events.
Or even advertising. Ads often rely on imagery and carefully crafted language to influence our desires and purchasing decisions.
Exactly.
It's like we're constantly being bombarded with messages that are trying to shape our perceptions of the world.
Right.
So how can we as readers and consumers use these insights to become more aware of the messages we're being fed and to critically evaluate them?
That's a crucial question.
Yeah.
And I think the answer lies in developing a critical eye.
Okay.
We need to become more aware of the techniques that authors and creators use to convey their messages, whether those messages are about politics, society, or even just selling us a product.
So it's not just about passively consuming information, but actively engaging with it. Right.
Oh, got it.
We need to look beyond the surface, question what we're being told.
Uh-huh.
And form our own conclusions.
Exactly.
By understanding how authors use satire, irony, allegory, and symbolism, we can become more discerning readers, more critical thinkers, and ultimately more empowered individuals.
Right.
It's like being a detective looking for clues and piecing together the evidence to uncover the truth.
Mm.
And that's a skill that's becoming increasingly valuable in our information-saturated world.
It is.
But before we get too caught up in the metaphorical detective work, let's take a moment to reflect on what we've learned today. We've covered a lot of ground, from the basic definitions of satire and irony to the complexities of allegory and symbolism in Animal Farm.
It's been quite a journey through the world of literary devices.
It has.
And I hope you're starting to see how these techniques aren't just academic concepts, but tools that can help you better understand the world around you.
I know I am. It's like having a new lens through which to view literature, art, and even everyday life.
Exactly.
But before we wrap things up, I'm curious to hear your thoughts on how our listener can apply these insights to their own life.
Okay.
Beyond the pages of a book or the screen of a TV. How can they take what they've learned today and use it to navigate the complexities of the real world?
That's a great question, and one that we'll explore further in the final part of our deep dive.
Oh.
We'll discuss how to apply these literary concepts to everyday situations, how to become more aware of the messages we're constantly bombarded with, and how to develop a more critical and discerning eye.
Sounds good.
So stay tuned for the final part of our deep dive, where we'll tie everything together and leave you with some actionable takeaways that you can use to enrich your understanding of the world.
Welcome back to the final part of our deep dive into satire, irony, allegory, and symbolism. We've been exploring how authors use these tools to make us think, laugh, and sometimes even question everything we thought we knew.
It's amazing how these techniques, often found in literature, pop up everywhere.
Right.
We've talked about late night comedy, political cartoons, even advertising.
And as we wrap up this deep dive, I think it's important to connect all of this back to you, the listener.
Okay.
We've explored these literary devices in detail, but the real question is, how can you apply these insights to your own life?
Well, think of it this way.
Okay.
We're constantly bombarded with information and messages.
Right.
From the news we consume to the conversations we have.
Mm-hmm.
Developing a critical eye.
Okay.
Being able to recognize these techniques when you encounter them.
Yeah.
It's like having a superpower.
It's like you're suddenly able to see the matrix.
Right.
You can decode those messages, understand the underlying intentions, and ultimately make more informed decisions about how you engage with the world. Imagine watching a political speech and being able to spot the subtle uses of exaggeration or irony to sway the audience.
Mm-hmm.
Or recognizing how a particular advertisement uses symbolism to appeal to your emotions and desires.
Right.
It's like having X-ray vision for the subtext of everything around you.
Exactly.
And that can be incredibly empowering.
It can.
It allows you to think for yourself.
Yeah.
To question the narratives you're being presented with.
Right.
And to form your own conclusions.
Precisely.
It's about moving from being a passive consumer of information to an active participant.
Right.
Someone who critically analyzes and evaluates the messages they encounter.
You got it.
This deep dive has really highlighted for me the importance of being an active reader, not just in literature, but in life.
Absolutely.
It's about recognizing that everyone has an agenda, a perspective, a story they're trying to tell, and understanding the tools they use to tell that story can help you navigate the world with more awareness and insight. So as we wrap up, what's one key takeaway you hope our listener walks away with today?
I hope they remember that these literary devices aren't just academic concepts.
Right.
They're powerful tools for understanding the world around us.
Mm-hmm.
By paying attention to how they're used, we can unlock deeper layers of meaning, challenge our assumptions, and ultimately become more critical and engaged citizens.
That's a powerful message. It's a reminder that knowledge is power.
It is.
And understanding how language and storytelling work can be incredibly empowering.
Mm-hmm.
So keep exploring.
Yeah.
Keep questioning.
Right.
And keep using those newfound superpowers to navigate the complexities of the world around you.
And remember, the world is a never-ending story full of twists, turns, and hidden meanings.
Right.
Enjoy the journey.
That's a great note to end on.
Yeah.
Until next time, keep those critical thinking caps on.
Okay.
And happy reading.